Continue our series in the book of Galatians, a message that I've titled, We Aim to Please. And that verse is all about pleasing mankind. When we fear what other people think of us, we aim to please the wrong person. And as I was thinking about it this week, you know, for most people, there are three options for that we have as far as our aim in life, as far as pleasing others. Some people aim to please mankind. I have a little bit of that people pleaser in me. I don't like people mad at me. If I can help it, I do what I can to keep from doing that. But some people, on the other side of the spectrum, they want others to please them. They don't care so much about what others think as long as they're happy. And those are the two, I think, fallen over reactions in this world. But really, we're going to see today, Paul is going to lead by example in that we should be aiming to please the Father. We should be having as our goal in life to please God in whatever we do. And you see that the fallen reaction of man, I want to please other men, I want to please myself. Really what we're supposed to have is a desire, an aim, a goal of pleasing the Father. And hopefully we'll see that in the scripture as we read together today. So we're going to begin at Galatians chapter 1, starting at verse 10. So if you want to go ahead and turn there in your Bible right now, we can go ahead and do that. Galatians 1, verse 10 says, For am I now seeking the favor of men or of God? Or am I striving to please men? If I were still trying to please men, I would not be a bondservant of Jesus Christ. And as I read this, I look at this and go, wow, Paul is saying, I'm not falling in that trap of wanting to please mankind. My goal is to please the Father. Now, just a little bit of history here. Christianity starts and is considered by many in the Roman world of that day to be just another sect of Judaism. You know, you had the Essenes, they had their own way of practicing Judaism, and then you had other groups, you had the Pharisees and the Sadducees, there were all these different groups within Judaism. And so Roman society just saw Christianity as just one more Jewish sect. Who knows what those crazy Jews are up to now, but you know, they're just all kind of a group, and they, you know. The important part of that is, Roman society recognized Judaism as an accepted faith. An accepted religion. And so, for a time, it allowed Christianity to grow without much persecution. Although we see over time that persecution does come. We see Stephen stoned in the book of Acts. We see a rejection on the part of Judaism and the synagogue life of the day, the rejection of Christianity. And you see, Paul is kind of referring back to his own history. Paul was a Pharisee. In fact, he says, I was advancing in Phariseeism above all of my contemporaries. In other words, to put it in like high school terms, Paul was part of the it crowd, the in crowd. He had everything a Jewish man could desire. He had influence. He had power. I believe he had money. Jesus talked a lot about you Pharisees are you chase after wealth. Paul had all of that. But Paul is saying, I gave all that up when I chose to become a slave of Jesus Christ. And he's saying that basically what he's inferring here is, and he's going to address this later on in the book, but he's saying these false teachers are coming in and trying to inject parts of Judaism into Christianity to make it more palatable to the Jews. To make it more acceptable, well, okay, if you're going to be part of Judaism, if Christianity is just another group within Judaism, then, well, you need to circumcise all your men. And you need to at least celebrate the High Holy Days. We're going to see this later on in the book. He's going to talk about these false teachers who are coming in to make Christianity more palatable to the Jewish community. And Paul says, no, they're trying to keep us pleasing to other men. Paul says, our big concern, my big drive is to be acceptable and pleasing to God. That's what Paul cares about. Now, there is sort of a balance here that we need to keep. I have met some Christians that say, well, I'm just going to offend people, so I'm just going to be as offensive as I can. I'm just going to, you know, oh, it's offensive. Okay, well, I'll just be mean and cruel and tell people judgmental and tell people they're all going to hell. That is true. Without Jesus Christ, every person is going to end up in the lake of fire, but we don't necessarily need to be the cause of offense. You and I don't need to be the cause of offense. Jesus and his words will offend enough on their own. They don't need us getting in the way. And I see in Romans the balance. Romans chapter 12, verse 18. If possible, so far as it depends on you, be at peace with all men. He's saying, don't just, you know, we had a scripture reading this morning. Don't be a slave to the fear of men. Because otherwise you want to change the gospel because it's not acceptable to lost humanity. But also, don't be one who is needlessly offensive. I hope you're catching this balance. Let Jesus offend. We talked a couple weeks ago about how Jesus said, I'm the only way to the Father. Paul said there's only one gospel. You cannot be changed. If it is changed, it's not really a gospel at all. Let the Word of God do the offending. You and me don't need to be the offensive party. I hope you're tracking with me, because if we're true to the gospel, it will be offensive on its own. It doesn't need our help at all. But just to tell people today there's only one path to God is offensive enough. It bothers our culture because so many people say, well, you know, as long as they're sincere, as long as they're trying, and they're trying to live a good moral life and all kinds of excuses, Jesus offends those people deeply. He says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And Paul is saying, I didn't come up with this gospel. And so our first fill-in today is that when you and I please Jesus, we will always displease some people. If you struggle with being a people pleaser, this is a real problem for you. Because I don't want to displease people. I want kind of everybody to like me. You know, I'm much more comfortable that way. But the reality of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the reality of the Bible, is that it will offend lost people. There's no way around that. Some people will not be happy with you if you stay true to God's word. But the question is then, who am I seeking to please? Paul says, I'm no longer trying to please men. I'm trying to please God. And is that your aim? I hope so. When you look at the life of Jesus, you can see how kind he was to the broken, to the outcast. It's a reminder, like we saw in Romans 12:18. The gospel will offend, but you and I are to be loving. You and I are to be winsome. You and I are to be kind, are to picture the mercy and the love of God in how we live our lives. All the while knowing there will be people that will hate us as we follow Christ. Paul goes on in Galatians 1, verse 11, for I would have you know, brethren, that the gospel which was preached by me is not according to man. For I neither received it from man, nor was taught it, but I received it through the revelation of Jesus Christ. This is why we don't change the word of God. This is why we stay true to the Word of God. We want to understand it, to know it, to live it. Because it's not from Paul. It's not something that Peter dreamed up. It's not something that the 12 got together in the upper room and said, hey, you know, this Jesus is now dead. I think he was really onto something. Maybe we should start our own religion. No, they were locked in a room for fear. They didn't come up with this. He did. The God of the universe, the God who spoke and made everything we see, is the one who came up with this plan. There's a new song out that we sang a couple weeks ago at a big event we went to, and it kind of bothered me. It talks about the reckless love of God. And I don't find that anywhere. What I find is, he chose you before the foundations of the world. That's not recklessness. That is a plan that existed before time as we know it existed. And I'm not trying to pick on that song. I think there's a misunderstanding of one of the parables of Jesus behind it. But I want us to see this is something that God is in control of. God has planned out. God has laid out before the foundation of the world. And it is not the plan of the disciples. It is not something that Paul dreamed of. It is something that the God of the universe came up with. Because of his love for humanity, because of his desire to display his glory to the watching angelic realm. Paul says, I didn't come up with this. This is from God himself. Now, just in practical terms today, anybody who has a street address gets all kinds of messages. Paul said this message is from God, but we are so used to getting messages from man. Do you remember maybe being younger and you get that Publisher's Clearinghouse envelope that says, you may have already won the latest gift they were giving away, the latest prize. And you get excited as a kid, and you realize as an adult, they're kind of playing games with you. Because you may have a chance of 1 in 120 million winning that prize that they said you may have already won. Or you know, we all get spam in our inbox. This is a picture of my inbox from last week. You know, you get messages that are untrustworthy, things that you don't want, things that you shouldn't follow. We are used to getting messages that are not trustworthy. Paul's whole argument is this message is totally trustworthy because it's from the God of the universe. Here's a picture of another message you may get. Now, this one happened to me on my way here. I'm moving, and you got a picture of this. I've got a 46-foot trailer on the back of a 22-foot-long truck. It weighed tons and tons. And I had to pass another truck that was going more slowly than I was. So I got in the left lane, got around it, and got back in the right lane as soon as I could. That took a long time because he was 53 feet long plus the truck, and I'm about the same length. So this woman passes me and points over at me, and like angrily points at me. And I'm going, what's going on? At first I thought, maybe I blew a tire on the trailer. I'm freaking out because that happened to us once on a move a long time ago. We blew a trailer, didn't even have a trailer tire, didn't even know it, and somebody's pointing. The problem is if you blow one tire, it always takes out the other two around it and destroys it. Then you have three flats and only one spare, and you're really sunk. So I'm like, oh no, what is this message? Why is she pointing at me? And then finally I realize it's because she felt that I shouldn't ever be in the left lane. And I'm going, you have no authority to tell me not to be in the left lane. I was doing the speed limit. No matter how much you wanted to go faster than the speed limit, I had a right to be there too. So we've all got messages around us all the time. Some that are untrustworthy. Some that don't have the authority to speak. But what if you actually got a message that did? Now, this is a letter written with the authority of President Truman and Mrs. Truman, inviting some citizens of the U.S. to an event in Washington, D.C. Now imagine if you opened your mail and you got this. Now today, you'd be late. You've been lost for decades in the mail. But, you know, back then it would have been pretty exciting, right? It would have been a kind of a wow moment of the President of the United States inviting you by name to an event. That would be special, wouldn't it? And here Paul is saying, the God of the universe is inviting you to the greatest party ever, known as heaven. Not a party of drunkenness or debauchery, but a party of holy celebration of who God is and what he did in Jesus Christ. And Paul says, I didn't cook. This is the plan of God. Now, and as I was thinking about this, Hebrews chapter 2 came to mind. It says, for this reason, we must pay much closer attention to what we've heard so that we do not drift away from it. Like that invitation from President Truman, can you imagine if you realize the day after the event? It's the 16th. I was supposed to do something yesterday. Can you imagine how sad? That'd be one of those things you would remember for the rest of your life. yeah, I got invited to the White House and I forgot to go. Yeah. And here the author of Hebrews says we have to pay attention to the invitation, to the gospel, to the word that we've been given so that we don't drift away. Now the book of Hebrews is written to people further down the line than Galatians, probably in about 70-ish AD. Another 20 years past the writing of Galatians, and the split has been finalized, and Christians are no longer welcome in Jewish synagogues. In fact, to join most synagogues, you have to call down a curse on anyone who would say Jesus was the Messiah. A curse on yourself, should you say that. And this book is saying that these people are wanting to wander back into the synagogues to be protected as a recognized faith under Rome. And the author of Hebrews is saying, do not drift away. Because that same theme is there. This is the message from God that's unalterable. Now, one note of Bible study practice. Whenever you see a phrase like, for this reason, or therefore, please stop and ask why. Please don't just read past it, because the therefore is saying, because of what's true, because of what we've already talked about, this reality needs to come home in your life. This reality needs to be firmly rooted in your life. Now, I went back and I decided to try and find out what is this for this reason here. Why is that? And if you look back, it's actually all the way back to Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 through 4. God, after he spoke long ago to the fathers and the prophets in many portions and in many ways, in these last days has spoken to us in his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, through whom he also made the world. And he is the radiance of his glory and the exact representation of his nature, and upholds all things by the word of his power. When he made purification for sin, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high, having become as much better than the angels, as he has inherited a more excellent name than they. And then we go back to, for this reason, why? Because Jesus Christ is greater than the angels. Jesus Christ, the book of Hebrews will also make the argument, Jesus Christ is greater than Moses, greater than the angels. Jesus Christ is the trustworthy Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. He's the prophet, the priest, and the king of our faith. And the author is going to say, because Jesus is trustworthy, what? We have to pay much more close attention to the invitation we've been mailed in the Word of God. For if the Word spoken through angels proved unalterable, that's the Old Testament, and every transgression and disobedience received a just penalty, anytime somebody disobeyed an angel or an angelic messenger, they paid the price, how will we escape if we neglect so great a salvation? After it was at first spoken through the Lord, it was confirmed to us by those who heard. God also testifying with them, both by signs and wonders and by various miracles and by gifts of the Holy Spirit according to his own will. It is a warning to us to take seriously the word of God. Because it's not the creation of Paul. It's not the creation of Peter or John. They are merely witnesses to what they saw and what they heard. And so, when you and I please Jesus, we will always displease some people. The second feeling is when the gospel is true, not because we believe it. It's true because he spoke. That's the whole point of Paul is, don't trust me, Paul's saying in this section in Galatians. Trust Jesus Christ. Put your faith in him, not in me. Now, Paul wants them to trust him as an apostle, one who's sent by the authority of God. But he's saying, I didn't come up with this message. Jesus Christ did. Jesus Christ, by the power of God, has planned this throughout eternity past and has now brought it to fullness in the person and work of his Son. Of his life on earth through the will of the Father, I should say. So remember that. The It's not true because I believe it. So many people today will say, well, that's great for you because you believe that. But Hindus are going to heaven too. It's just that they, you know, everybody believes in the same God. You know, I have a neighbor who's a friend who's a Hindu. I have a guy I know who's a Muslim. And people say, well, you know, as long as they're sincere, all this stuff. But no, they call Jesus a liar. They're saying he's not the Messiah for a Muslim, that there's other ways to God for a Hindu. Jesus is true. Jesus is trustworthy. And we do ourselves and our world a great disservice when we don't proclaim that, when we don't hold fast to that. Because he's God, because he spoke through his prophets, through his apostles, in his word, that's why we believe it. That's why we trust it. And the thing is, it is so trustworthy that it's worthy to spend, it's a worthy pursuit to spend the rest of our lives seeking to let others know about it. Paul is worried about the purity of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And I'm still worried about that same thing today. I'm concerned with what I like to call, you know, cotton candy, bubblegum Christianity that never challenges a person, that never causes us to grow. Just, oh, the grace of God is like a big comfy chair and we can just do whatever we want. God will forgive us. And I see that happening more and more. I see that in some of the songs and some of the attitudes and some of the messages, the ways Christianity is portrayed. And it doesn't line up with the Bible. And the big concern is, it doesn't line up with what he spoke. The message that's been given once for all. The message that's been given so that even if Paul changes his mind from the last time he spoke, or an angel from heaven comes with a different gospel, don't believe him. Let him be sent to hell forever. I want the word of God. I'm broken, I'm fallen. I don't always live it. And if you're really honest, you don't either. But this is how we know if we're pleasing God. This is how we know if we're succeeding in that aim to please. Because we will either seek to please men, be popular, or we'll seek to please ourselves, have others please us, or we'll be seeking to please the Lord. And I hope your desire is to please the Lord. And I'm convinced one of the things that you and I can do brings great pleasure to the Lord is to share the gospel. Now, before we do this, part of the gospel is that you and I can never please God on our own. Apart from the work of God through Jesus, by the power of the Holy Spirit, to make us holy, to make us like Christ, we will never please him. We cannot earn the pleasure of God as a moral standing on our own. But our action, we are given that in Christ. That moral standing is won in Christ. That judicial forgiveness is won in Christ. But I see the Bible is full of times when God is well pleased with his servants who are faithful to do what he's called them to do. There's a double element here. We're holy in Christ, but we're also called now to what? To live like Christ. Jesus said, I came to seek and to save that which was lost. So I want to encourage us, I know I shared this a couple weeks ago, but here's another part of the scripture where the gospel is the core. The gospel is what's most important. And this is just a tool to help us communicate it to other people, because I am convinced that God is very much pleased when we share the gospel with the lost world around us. Because if it's an invitation from the God of the universe, and it's open to anybody, why wouldn't we share it with everybody? Really, the reason that we wouldn't is we're afraid of people. We want to, but because of the fear of men, we want to please other people instead of pleasing the Lord. And so, The Cliff Notes version of the gospel, the condensed, the 30-second version of the gospel, is God created us to be with him. You think about the garden. He walked with them in the cool of the day. Our sin separates us from God. The end of the garden. And then he puts angels at the entrance of the garden so they can't get in and eat of the tree of life. Sins cannot be removed by good deeds. The Bible says without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins. Paying the price for sin, Jesus died and rose again. And Paul's saying that's what the whole book of Galatians is about. The first five chapters focus on the sufficiency of the sacrifice of Jesus Christ to forgive our sins. We don't gain forgiveness of sins by inviting others to the good news. We only get that through Jesus Christ. But now our behavior pleases God when we do invite others to come and be forgiven. Everyone who trusts in Jesus alone has eternal life. And life with Jesus starts now and lasts forever. If you ever want to explain it to somebody, the brief version, this is one great tool to do just that. Because the thing is, this book is an open invitation. That letter that I showed from President Truman, it just had two people, a husband and a wife, who were invited. Not everybody in the States, not everybody in the country. But only two people. But according to this, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son. And we can go into election and all that stuff, but hear me on this, please. The Bible doesn't contain a list of names who are the elect, who are not. Our job is to invite everyone. And the Holy Spirit will call those who've been chosen before the foundation of the world, according to Ephesians chapter 1. He will call them through you and through me. So spread the invitation. Why? Because it's trustworthy. Because the fear of man is a snare will keep us from doing what God's called us to do. But when we aim to please the Father and live this out, we will invite lost people to come to the greatest party the universe has ever known. Not a party of drinking, debauchery, sin, but a party celebrating the most beautiful being ever. The most beautiful character ever in the person and work of Jesus Christ. So I want to invite you to make your aim this week to please God. Every day, imagine how life would be different if that was your aim. You woke up and said, you know what? Heard that message in church on Sunday, and we're supposed to aim not to please ourselves, not to please mankind, but to please God. So God, how can I please you today? How can my behavior please you? Knowing that your moral standing, your righteousness is in Christ, but God still cares about your behavior. Both sides of a coin, they're inseparable. Because his Holy Spirit is in us. Because we've been saved, we're now empowered to walk a new life, no longer to be snared by the fear of man, which would keep us from sharing the gospel. And keep us from really valuing it for what it is, the greatest invitation the world has ever known. Father, I thank you for today. I thank you for each person that's here. I thank you. There are so many of us here who have accepted that call, that invitation to the great party, the great feast that will be heaven one day. And Father, I pray that you would help each one of us to live each day to please you. I need your help by your power of your, by the power of your Holy Spirit to live to please you. We each need that power today. And would you help us, Lord, to be those who wouldn't be afraid of sharing the gospel, who wouldn't be afraid of inviting others to avoid the lake of fire and come to the greatest party the universe has ever seen. Thank you for that invitation. And thank you for the work of Jesus Christ. We pray this in your Son's mighty name.